dirt road in town. By the lake, not far from the sea, you and me.
Members of Hopkinton 300 Anniversary Celebration Committee, representatives of Project Just Because, Michael Carter Listener Center and Serenity House, poetry contributors, friends of Hopkinton. Good evening. Hey, good evening.
Good evening.
Yeah. My name is Cynthia Franca in Portuguese, Cynthia Franca in English. Thank you so much for coming tonight to celebrate our Hopkinton with poetry. You are very welcome to the Hopkinton Through Poetry celebrating 300 years book launch and poetry reading.
I think we should clap.
Yes, clap, please. Yes. You are very welcome to the Hopkinton Through Poetry celebrating 300 years.
I'm here first to tell you a little bit of the history of this anthology before we get to the reading. And the story goes that it is less than a year. Actually, it was right about this time last year that Cynthia approached me and said she had this idea of creating a book for our town by the people, for the people of poetry, because she knows that I host different poetry events in town. Unfortunately, when she told me the idea, I was a little preoccupied at the time with teaching a new course unfamiliar to me, and I said, not now, Cynthia, later on. So we revisited the idea in about January or February, and quickly the idea unfolded with the vision that Cynthia had to create this book of poems by the people, and hopefully in time for celebrating Hopkinton's 300th anniversary. And so I am here to say thanks to the cooperative spirit of the many people involved in our community. We made this dream of Cynthia's happen.
Thank you.
In less than a year, and just in time, in November, before the end, for the 300th anniversary of Hopkinton. We put the call out, the invitation, to the public in different ways, and we were hoping for 30 poems, and we actually exceeded the goal with 36 people of different generations and different walks of life who contributed. It's also important to know that this is intended as a self-sustaining kind of a project in the sale of the book, with people helping people through poetry. As we asked each contributor to pay a slight fee to help us with the publishing, so all the proceeds of the 300 limited edition books we have to sell will be divided and donated to our three local organizations that service people in need in our community, including Project Just Because, the Michael Carter List Now Center, and Serenity House. So the way we see it, there is a circular nature to this project in people bringing their poems, sharing them out in anthology and tonight in public, and that they're going back out to the community to celebrate the anniversary and to the people in our different organizations in town as well. So you're all a part of that this evening as well.
Thank you. Thank you, Cheryl.
And when I shared with Cheryl the idea of creating an anthology of poetry to celebrate Hopkinton, I actually want to offer a gift to Hopkinton, a thank you gift to every person of this amazing community that my family and I had the honor of meeting. Coming from Brazil and living here for now 3 years, I discovered that there do not have to be boundaries, cultural difference, and even accents that set us apart. You are all human beings with dreams, families and relationships, life projects and communities. In addition to the poems, we decide to ask each contributor to say what they love most about the town, and that was included in the book as well. Each poem here is an alive portrait of the admiration, from different generations for Hopkinton. It is this vision that we are honored to share with you this evening.
To help us begin this celebratory event for our town at this time, we would like to invite Jean Birchman to the stage to share a few words as chair of the Hopkinton 300th Anniversary Celebration Committee. Please give a welcome for Jean Birchman.
I want to very briefly say thank you so much to Cynthia and Cheryl for pulling all of this together and for donating a copy of the book for us to include in the time capsule. So people in 50 years, when they open up our time capsule, will have the pleasure of reading all of these reflections about Hopkinton. And I just will briefly say I had the opportunity to read this last night, and it just really struck me, the common theme, and I'm sure you'll hear it when people are reading their poems, just it really feels like home here. It's all about community and sense of pride, and so the poems are lovely, and I'm sure you'll enjoy hearing them as soon as people get underway. So I wanted to say thank you very much for them to both of them for bringing this to the committee's attention. And as a little plug, I will let you know that we also have an event on Sunday afternoon at 3:00. There's music through the years, 300 years of music, being played on the organ at St. Paul's Church, which was originally in the Congregational Church on the Town Common. It's from 1882. So it's some beautiful organ music available on Sunday afternoon, and then our closing ceremonies will be on December 11th at the Center for the Arts. So we hope to see all of you there. And in between, you can go see Our Town presented by Enter Stage Left. So thank you very much again, and I look forward to hearing everybody's poems. Thanks.
Thank you, Cheryl.
At this time, we would like to thank you, Hopkinton Senior Center, for hosting us tonight, and Pat is helping us tonight too. We would like to thank the wonderful 36 contributing writers who truly have honored the town of Hopkinton with their poetry. The 36 contributors in the anthology are Peter Lagoy, Polly Brown, Kate Hyde, Trish Perry, Bill Shander, Kathleen Dinsmore, John V. Puri, I hope it's correct, Holly Peharik, Nivaya Tamba, Diane Norby, Hibiscus Rose, Michael Alfano, Cheryl Melody Rosenblum, Sherilyn Lambert Walsh, Jerry Holland, Michelle Floria, Dan Cloutier, Kat Taylor.
And the second group includes Linda Havel, Liam Palacios, Catherine Weber, Barbara Kessler, John Ritz, Jeffrey Barnes, Cheryl Perreault, Amanda Maffei, Hal Glicklin, Libby Frank, Vivek Datar, Meg Tyler, Agnes Pine Free, Marjorie Tugian, Louise Ina Hetzler, Sterling Hager, Denise Antaki, and Cynthia Franca.
Thank you.
And Louise.
You would like to give a special thanks to Tom Sloan, winner of the first prize in the Hopkinton Past, Present, Future Photography Contest, for the authorization to use his beautiful photography through the stone HCA at sunset for the front cover in the anthology.
We thank the Hopkinton 300th Anniversary Committee for endorsing this project and for their support, in particular, Jean Birchman and Michelle Murdoch. Also, we'd like to give a big thank you to the Hopkinton Historical Society, Waterfresh Farm, and HCAM TV for providing us with additional support for this project. Now we're ready for the presentations.
Yeah. And now you are at the point of sharing some of the poems and sources of inspiration that you will find in this anthology. We are simply reading each name. You can learn more about the contributors in the book.
Now with you. I have the first poem to share this evening for Sterling Hager. Sterling we had the honor of having Sterling contribute a poem, but he is not able to join us this evening. Sterling, as some of you might know, is our oldest resident in Hopkinton. In December, he will have his birthday turning 104. And he was hoping to come, actually, this evening and read his poem or be represented, but he's not well at this time. So let's keep him in our thoughts, and if anyone wants to send him a letter, he's in the phone book. I'm sure he'd love to hear you at this time. I also had the privilege of interviewing Sterling for 3 Meet Your Neighbor interviews over time. And I would recommend taking a look at HCAM TV to learn more about him and his stories. And he contributed this poem, which is called Survivor. And it is about dealing with aging and being maybe the oldest resident in town for a while. And he looks at it this way, but what also came with this poem, which is about the hard part of aging and dealing with challenges, is his praise of the senior center in playing wheelchair volleyball, I believe, and bingo and other events that he appreciated here, and in the friends he has had at Hopkinton. Survivor. I never liked being called a senior citizen. Survivor is much preferred by me. My life was molded by my genes, God-given. What I have done was meant to be. As others have dropped by the wayside, for one reason or another, my life has been one long ride with one problem after another. With no end in sight, each day follows the last, and so I just might, as in the past, be a survivor. So our thoughts are with Sterling Hager. Thank you. We would like to call Peter LeGoy to share his poem, Small Bridge, the first poem in our poetry anthology.
Thank you, Cheryl. This poem was written about an entranceway to Hopkinton. The bridge itself is actually in Southboro. It's the bridge at the end of Cedar Street Extension. And the poem itself is Small Bridge. On the way home, I cross a small bridge over the railroad tracks. Looking left and right down the long tracks, no trains, just endless possibilities. To left, straight tracks to the Atlantic, stretching to continents and oceans beyond, forever sea of endless possibilities. To right, tracks stretching to Worcester, then west and south and north, intertwining labyrinth covering the spaces of America, thousands of miles and millions of people, billions of endless possibilities. I cross the small bridge, I drive to my house, I pick up the kids, and I think, life here is quieter than the ocean, less expansive than the West, but still, the possibilities, endless. Thanks.
And thank you, Peter. Representing Hopkinton High School, we invite John B. Puri to read her poem, Hopkinton. You're welcome the brave way or with a step.
Hello, Hopkinton. I'm so glad to be here tonight. How is everyone?
Good.
I would like to share a poem I made about Hopkinton a couple months ago, just representing the community spirit we have here, as well as the small town charm that we all know and love. So here we go. O town of Hopkinton, your small town charm welcomes everyone from near and afar. You are filled with community activities and civic pride. You inhabit scientists, teachers, poets, musicians, and celebrity stars. How I love to call you home, sincere and bona fide. O town of Hopkinton, you leave an enormous footprint towards the future. With new businesses, community projects, the famous Boston Marathon, and friendly citizens, you fulfill the hopes and American dreams of many, leaving behind a trail of watchers. Here's to a bright future full of accomplishments and a grand vision. O town of Hopkinton, let's celebrate the changes, opportunities, and memories you brought. With three centuries filled with history and community spirit, and still continuing to embrace the present and enlightening our future thoughts, how I love your sweet smelling aroma and community unity you bring. Let's take time to reflect on your honor of merit today. Thank you.
And thank you, John B. Representing Elmwood School, we now invite Holly Paharik and her poem, Hopkinton Common. All right, I'm gonna help you with this.
Hopkinton Common by Holly Paharik. Feel the green grass, smell the sweet flowers, hear the gentle wind. People going by saying, hi, how are you? See the hard, cold statue, loud music, kids dancing. That is the word of the common.
And thank you, Holly. Navaya? I did not get to meet you yet, and I was wondering if you could help me correctly say your name.
Navaya.
Navaya Tamba. Is that right?
Navaya Tamba.
This is Navaya Tamba with us, also from Elmwood School, to share her poem, Boston Marathon. Thank you for coming this evening.
Boston Marathon by Navaya Tamba. As the people come running by, I look at them and say hi. Even though we stood there all day, I hear people clap as they run far away. We wish them a good job as they jogged, and when it's all over and gone, Hopkinton is still the start of the Boston Marathon.
Time, we are honored to have Massachusetts State Representative Carolyn Dykema to offer a few words. Please join me in giving a welcome to Senator Representative Carolyn Dykema.
Good evening, Hopkinton. And happy birthday again for your 300th. It is really wonderful that the celebration continues, and I want to say thanks again to Jean and her tremendous group of friends that have put together and continue the festivities to recognize the 300th. It's really wonderful to be here. And if I really were on the ball, I would have a poem here, given that I'm sort of in between the poetry, which is not an enviable place to be. But the wonderful thing about poetry is that you don't have to be able to write it to appreciate it. And I want to thank all of the participants tonight for sharing their wonderful thoughts about the community, and I think whether you write it or whether you listen to it, everyone here appreciates the sentiments that are represented here. I do have to recognize Cynthia, because for all of the emotional connection that we have to the community of Hopkinton as residents, I think nothing speaks louder than a three-year resident of the town standing up and feeling so passionately about this community to really put forward an effort like this to share that love and emotional connection with everyone else. So Cynthia, I want to thank you and give you a round of applause for this wonderful evening. say, and there's some kind of odd noise going on back here. I don't know if we can hear that. And I also want to say that I think it's so appropriate that there is an artistic venue as part of the 300th anniversary, because having been associated with Hopkinton now for about 7 years, I can tell you that the flavor and the fabric of this community so significantly encompasses the arts. Wherever you look, the HCA, which is going to be opening, the tremendous artistic community there, I have just really been surrounded by the arts ever since I've been in Hopkinton. So the fact that we've taken time to make this artistic tribute, and how else do we, as a humanity, convey our deep emotional connections but through the arts? So here we are, and it's wonderful to be a part of it. And thank you all, especially to all of our artists and our poets tonight who participated. And I look forward to hearing more. Thank you all, and thank you, Cheryl.
Thank you, Representative Carolyn Dykema. To follow, we have someone from history to join us now, and that is Lady Agnes Surridge Franklin, played by storyteller Libby Frank. So please welcome someone in history to join us at this time.
Fisherman's daughter of Marblehead, tough, strong, clever, bold. Male poets lusted after her in rhyme, alluring bosom, dark eyes and hair. Sings like a bird, they said. Sir Harry, Bengal born to West India Company traders, seduced her, a child of 14. She bore and hid her secret love child, Henry Cromwell. Marblehead fishermen and sailors taunted her. All Boston called her promiscuous. Yet she transformed from chambermaid to lady, changing her speech like Eliza Doolittle, her walk, her manners, from scrubbing the floors to dancing on them. She did fit in, but still they mocked her. Sir Harry built a love nest here in Hopkinton, English manor house, horses, slaves, gardens with fruit trees, lilacs, fox hunts, wassail parties, midnight revels, far from Boston's censorious eyes and tongues. Here, Henry Cromwell romped with her sister's children, fishing, hunting, whooped like savages in woods and streams. But duty called from England. Harry and Agnes sailed to London court, their son at sea with the Royal Navy. In England, Harry's family shunned Agnes coldly. They fled to Lisbon, city of licentiousness and wealth, to help their social standing. In a tiny chapel, Agnes and Harry wed. Above its doorway, carved in Latin, our vows performed, we go in peace. November 1st, 1775, All Souls Day, an earthquake shook Lisbon. But Agnes and Harry survived, along with many myths about them. Sir Harry and Lady Franklin, respectable, at last sailed back to Boston. Ill health forced Harry to Lisbon as ambassador, then retired to England, where he died. Widow Franklin and her admiral's son returned to Boston and Hopkinton until the Revolution forced flight for England. Does Agnes' ghost haunt Franklin's manor still? remember this oft-told tale of a strong, brave woman, especially in the spring when fruit trees and lilacs bloom. Without Agnes, Sir Harry and all his kin would be but a brief note in the annals of history.
Thank you, Lady Agnes. Perhaps it's time for us to get our history books out and learn a bit more. Speaking of history, I would like to introduce Kathleen Dinsmore to this stage to share her poem, Roots of Hopkinton.
Thank you, Cheryl and Cynthia. Roots of Hopkinton. In the early 1930s, living on Hayden Row, perhaps first as a boarder doing odd jobs for the friend landlord to earn room and board, then moving in with family, his brother Mel, sister-in-law Ruth, and baby Ruthie, his niece, staying on Hayden Row, this time at house number 37, doing what he could to scrape by and help his family and himself during the Depression, attending meetings at the Grange and driving to Worcester or Boston to catch a play or movie, going to church and enjoying Sunday dinner with family, spending the day with his sweetheart, named what else but Ruth, driving Ruth home until the next weekend for hopefully another cherished time together, and after a hard day's work driving a delivery truck, making repairs, or helping on the farm, making time to write one more endearing letter to his, quote, peach of a sweetheart. Such is the brief glimpse I've been lucky to glean of the few years my paternal grandfather, Arthur V., lived and worked in Hopkinton, Massachusetts. Unbeknownst to those of us currently living until a few years ago, when my parents gifted me a box of letters written to my grandmother, Ruth. Bit by bit, the contents of these seemingly mundane letters are revealed to me in chronological order, with gaps for me to ponder about and try to fill. Each word lovingly written to Ruth, whether by her mother sending news and dispensing advice, or the young man repeatedly declaring his admiration and love years before they married in 1936 and settled not in Hopkinton, but in Hartford, Connecticut. And here I am, 80 or so years later, transplanted in Hopkinton, an outsider 16 years ago who serendipitously ended up here with my husband. Now, thinking perhaps there was more drawing me here than the marathon spirit and open space. 2 years ago, during my habitual reading of the local newspaper, the Hopkinton Independent, I unexpectedly noticed my Auntie Ruth's name in print, remembered for playing Christmas carols on the piano at the farm of BAA founder George V. Brown at the annual Women's Club party. And just this spring, I spied her name on a quilt, provenance unknown, that was recently given to the Hopkinton Historical Society. As short a time as my ancestors lived in Hopkinton, they made memories and established roots here, just as the irises divided from my grandmother Ruth's flower bed are now planted in my garden, where my family experiences the joys and frustrations of life, spreading our own roots through Hopkinton, intertwined with family, friends, and neighbors of the past and present, reaching out to those of the future, meant to be here, home. Thank you.
And next we have a timely poem inspired by Halloween, Bear Hill Halloween by Trish Perry.
This is our job. Yes, so I'm a week late on this, but this refers to a very brief tradition that existed up on Bear Hill a number of years ago when we had first moved here. Wind howling, no stars, cold. We gathered, families, friends, in the Paquette's barn, Pond Street, 1976-77. Daughter, four, doesn't matter. Inside, warm and bright with all the usual, apple bobbing, cider drinking, crazy hyped up witches and supermen and ghosts flying around. Fun, fine, let's just keep it that way. But the moment came for the walk. Half a mile in the pitch dark, down the country road to the Love's house. Bleak trees creaked, broken down stone walls surrounded forgotten fields alive with spirits. We began to spread out, but the first shriek sent us into a huddle. Black figures darted around us, moans echoed, wails followed. A wooden casket, flashlight blinking on and off, housed an ancient living body, aura. Unforgettable, unrepeatable, Bear Hill Halloween.
Thank you, Trish. So you might be able to notice I'm having an interesting relationship with the microphone here. And it will go quiet, and I think all is well, and then I'm wondering if the HCAM mic, do you have any thoughts of that, Denise? Yeah, feedback. All right, we will keep up the dance. But just for you to know, this is Denise Antecki, and she's filming this program for HCAM TV. Representing the librarian perspective, we have Diane Norby with her poem, Hopkinton Middle School Library Students.
Good evening. My poem was inspired by my experiences as a librarian at the middle school. Hopkinton Middle School Library Students. Students spill into the variegated fabric of the middle school library. Palpable, excited, glittery footprints. Anticipation of adventure. Books, geodes, patiently waiting to be cracked open, reveal glistening crystals in radiant sunlight. Twinkling gemstones embedded in matrix capture effervescent migratory glances. They speak impeccable beauty, ruby red escapades, aquamarine blue serenity, yellow topaz mystery, emerald green knowledge, wealth of treasure. Students contentedly flow out of the middle school library, colorful, gleaming, iridescent gems in hand, anticipation of adventure. Thank you.
Now it's time to tell a love story about Hopkinton with Love Affair by Cheryl Melody Rosenblum.
My love affair with Hopkinton all began in a crazy way. We lived in Natick with a baby who wasn't sleeping night or day. A worried about my sanity husband volunteered to take a ride. A sleep-deprived wife weakly nodded, grateful he stood by her side. Putting our wide-awake boy in the car seat, away they went exploring. Of course, our child promptly dozed, finding the travels boring. My husband wandered here and there, driving around and around, until he found a special place, a beautiful little town. He said, the ground, the earth, feels better there. I can breathe and feel so free. Come for a ride with us, and I think you'll plainly see that the beauty of the lakes and land, the trees and woods and sounds will give us the kind of peace we enjoy. What beauty I have found. So 9 years later, the love affair grew passionate and strong. Two children in tow, we moved to Hopkinton and knew that we belonged. 9 years turned to 29, we raised our family here. And as we mature into older years, we still find this place so dear. And that precious baby who kept us up both night and by day has been a sound sleeper for a long time now, unharmed in any way. Difficult times led to good, loving Hopkinton at first sight. And I suppose thanking our son for those sleepless times is really only right.
No one is using it. So, you know, we might have a Hopkinton book of parenting tips that we can create. Thank you, Cheryl Melody, who is one of our talented singer-songwriters of town. And I just wanted to let you know, you can learn more about each contributor in the book, where there is some bio information and story about the poems. And speaking of singer-songwriter, we have Dan Cloutier now to join us. Dan represents the Michael Carter Lisnow Center, where he works. And he will be sharing words of poem and song, We Reflect Beauty.
Hi, good evening. I grew up in Hopkinton. I'm graduated in 1998 from the schools, but the thing I'm most proud about being associated with Hopkinton is the past 13 years, I've worked at the Respite Center, and some of my friends in the back, hi guys, in the back from the Respite Center, and Hopkinton has done a great job treating the Respite Center with the most dignity, and the people of the Respite Center are just so part of this town, and everyone there is very, very grateful. So what I was doing, I have a song that I wrote really inspired by the people of the Respite Center, but it doesn't really talk about Hopkinton. So what I did is I wrote a very short poem. And then I have a song. So I think what I'm going to do is play the song first, and then I'll read the poem. Let's see. I think I'll just stand out up here. I just play this old guitar. words for Hopkinton. We reflect beauty. We really do. It shines down Hayden Row. It lights up Grove Street. Main Street glows. Ignore the lying voices. You are not unique. You have no purpose. You are not loved. Let this beauty free. Let it shape our town. Let it form our streets. And let it be our foundation. So thank you.
Thank you, Dan. Representing Town Hall and the biggest nest in town, we have the poem Nest by Jerry Holland.
Helping me because I'm not old, because I fractured my foot in March, which is amazing that I was able to build that nest. So I dedicate this poem to all the women and ladies throughout the years who have allowed me to come and do art projects and art therapy. I love Serenity House and appreciate them. So I wrote this, the nest. And they're dedicated to them. The nest, hope imagined, hope realized. Grassy cup, widely diverse. Mud, grass, branches, sticks, stones, twigs, hay. Trees, vines, long, long vines. Twine, yarn, tight, tightly knotted. All woven, endless fibers, around and around. Repeating, repeating, looping over and over, strengthening, strong. The nest, all for the future generation. Feathers, flowers, shells, seaweed, messy, musty, jumble, all of Earth's good stuff. Gifts from above. Packing, smearing, mud, wet leaves, dry hay. Rain, please rain. Pills of mud, thank you God for the rain. The nest taking shape, beautiful. Determination, racing, diving, swooping, squealing, victory. All for the next generation. The egg. A clutch of small eggs, round, blue, white, spotted. All for the future generation. Protection, warmth, love, shelter. Eggs hatching, squealing, naked, clutching. Family. Fledgings, roosting, surviving, protecting, feeding, nurturing. Stronger, wings flapping, taking flight. All for the next generation. The nest, hope imagined, hope realized. Thank you.
Thank you, Jerry, and just a reminder, you can learn more about the nest story in the book, and perhaps we can call you Mama Bird. Representing Serenity House is Michelle Fluria with her poem, Finding Michelle.
Jerry, I love you. I was listening to everybody's poems and I forgot how nervous I was, and now I'm nervous all over again. So my name is Michelle Fluria, and the poem that I contributed to the book is called Finding Michelle. November 12th, 2012, a ski chalet, summer camp, weekend getaway. What is this place? Nestled deep in the woods of Hopkinton off Wilson Street, I found myself dragging what was left of my life behind me in trash bags, my mother in tow, crying. My first day there, I met someone who would later become my soul sister. She was gentle, warm, inviting, and kind. She settled my nerves and helped me unwind. Didn't sleep much that first night. Thoughts were so twisted. I did a ton of self-reflective work, especially the first 30 days, but the sisterhood you build helps you through it in many ways. We taught each other how to give and to receive. When things got real tough, we talked to each other so we wouldn't leave. Group discussions about things you would never tell anyone else. Yet for some reason, it always felt acceptable to just be yourself. 1 month in the kitchen to cook and to do dishes. Getting through that period made you queen of the kitchen. The weekends seemed boring at times, yet we bonded. Movies, ice cream, cards, and stories about us girls in all our glory. Journaling, poetry, drawing, knitting, and art with Jerry. Imagine, and we thought we hadn't any smarts. Hidden talents we never knew we had. Proud, excited, happy, and sad. Groups, counseling, meetings, and more. Full schedules and consequences for bad behavior, oh, what a score. Counselors I aspired to be like, this period changed the course of my life. Friendships and sisterhoods that I couldn't breathe without. My life wouldn't be the same, there is no doubt. Serenity House had magic. My sisters and the staff shaped me. Today, I am dignified, honorable, respectful, loyal, and true blue. The curse has been broken of the terrible twos. Just to explain a little bit, I went into Serenity House completely broken. I am a recovering addict, and I started working at Serenity House just volunteering. And I became a recovery specialist, and then I became full-time, and then I became Jane's assistant. And now I am no longer at Serenity House, I represent, and very proudly, by the way. And now I'm a case manager for SMOC, and I work with the homeless and chronically using alcohol and drugs. And I've been sober for almost 4 years. Thank you.
Michelle. And now we have a poem by Upton neighbor Kathy Taylor. We all belong to the Boston Marathon.
So, you know, when I was a kid, I grew up in Bedford, Lexington, Concord, and we always had Paul Revere in the battles. But when I moved in this area, there's a whole new thing for Patriots Day. So we all belong to the Boston Marathon. On Patriots Day, we awake at dawn, hearing Paul Revere shout across the bourbon lawn. Then from Charles River's start, runners dart all the way to the finish line. In Hopkinton, people gather ready to run. Thousands arrive and strive, setting a pace to finish the race. At the place the river flows out to the sea. Running fast, past all the rest, having a blast, cheering from both sides, spectators rise. We all make good time. Life is sublime.
Catherine?
Yes.
Okay. Another contributor from our neighbor Southborough is Catherine Weber, who will read her poem, An Old Barn.
A few years ago, I was scouting out barns for a series of paintings I was doing. It was also the time when my father had passed away. He was a farmer, and we had an old barn in upstate New York. Long, long time ago. So I'm driving down Saddle Hill Road and I see a barn, and I don't know if that person's in the audience, I don't know who lives there, but I stopped and I took pictures and I made a painting. And then came the poem, An Old Barn. An old barn gives me pause, half stripped of paint, planks askew, unhinged and lopsided. An old barn struggling to stand, having given shelter to sheep, cows, field mice and owls, their feed, their water. aloft, tools on a hook by the door, the smell of hay and manure, secrets hidden under the floor in a shoebox. An old barn will not give in until the planks are taken one by one by the elements or for firewood. I hear my father there, standing strong, holding fast before the wind took him away.
And thank you, Catherine. With the poem about family and Hopkinton places, we have Amanda Maffei sharing her poem, Hopkinton.
Hi. First, I wanted to dispel any rumors that I'm Agnes incarnate. I am from Marblehead, but I am not a fisherman's daughter. I'm a professor's daughter. But it's interesting. That was beautiful to hear that story from Libby. The poem I'll read for you actually does talk about childhood homes, and it comes at an interesting crossroads in my life because we just sold my dad's place in Marblehead. And it just, the mourning that comes with that, you know, after 55 years of having that home really in my fibers, you know, is, it's been a unanticipated, you know, response to it. But that's, I think that's detached enough language for now. So this is a Hopkinton for my children. Home to my first two children. Home to my third child, who followed a decade and a half later. Home to my two stepchildren. Second tier home to my husband and me. For it is the home of childhood that reigns supreme in our being. It is the contours of the landscapes we know in youth that form the landscapes within. The breadth and spread of Lake Whitehall, the icy traverse discovering a snowman, our yard where my daughter spun in her air-blooming twirly dress. Summer trips to Sandy Beach, watching both daughter and son joyously splash and churn. Our short explores back into the woods, the moss-covered rock they jumped off, the hollowed tree trunk they could hide in, the stream where we floated pine cone and leaf canoes. Then moving downtown Hopkinton, daily strolls with second-generation son in backpack with mirror to see his big, wide, curious eyes, stepping over downtown thresholds to give and receive daily greetings, to share daily stories and smiles, to the library for books ranging from strawberry shortcake to military tanks, exploring and hiking newfound trails, kayaking waterways, visiting beaver lodges, canoeing out to islands, and falling in. Though Hopkinton shall forever be my second-tier home, it will always come first. For here my heart dwells in the home that reigned first for my children.
Louise Ina Hetzler will now share her song, Whitehall.
Good evening, everyone. This is a song about Lake Whitehall.
Sky burning orange, sunset on the lake. Walking on a trail among tall pines, a pause I take. The water's a mirror, reflecting the sky. Birds call to one another. They fly by. Better than any window is the view from right down there, with the waves lapping upon the shore, and the wind blowing through my hair, and the wind blowing through my hair. Gazing at the lake until the orange turns to gray, I reverse my steps to home. to come back another day. Better than any window is the view from right down there, with waves lapping upon the shore and the wind blowing through my hair. Wind blowing through my hair. Sky of burning orange, sunset on the lake. Walking on a trail among tall pines, a pause I take. The water is a mirror, reflecting the sky. Birds call to one another as they fly by. Better than any window is the view from right down there. Waves lapping upon the shore and the wind blowing through my hair.
Thank you.
We have with us Hal Glicklin, who represents the Golden Pond side of town, with his poem Afterthought. We have a patron.
Thank you, Cheryl. Cheryl knows that I'm usually involved with nonsense and whimsy. This is one of the very few serious things that I've written. And I call it Afterthought. And I wrote this after my wife passed away. When my wife was informed of impending doom caused by an illness that has no cure, of course, it elicited feelings of gloom, and problems arose that were hard to endure. We faced it sensibly and tried to be brave, and with our time left, precious moments we'd save. We moved close to our family. We wished to be near. They lived in Hopkinton. That's why we're here. Assisted living in a convenient location made our lives more an extended vacation. All the folks in the town were gracious and kind. A pleasanter place would be quite hard to find. Hopkinton certainly can take much pride as a wonderful place in which to reside. When the end came to my wonderful wife, the concern of good people comforted my life. Much time has gone by, the grieving is past, and I'll treasure good memories that surely will last.
Thank you. Thank you, Hal. And I am waiting for your book. Vivek Datar is a former resident of Hopkinton who wrote his poem, Hopkinton's Soul, before moving.
Some say other towns have better schools, better homes, better views. Some may be so, but they're not Hopkinton, they're not home. What meager advantages other places have are nothing, because Hopkinton has soul, the soul of us, its inhabitants, its passengers, on the journey we know of as survival of life. This makes it our home, and there's no greater place, no greater thing anywhere in this miracle-filled world. Because the blood, the tears, the memories of those who live here vitalize us and Hopkinton itself.
We have just a few more poems. Meg Tyler comes from the lake side of town and will be sharing her poem, Nocturne, Lake Maspinock.
My husband and I are both swimmers, so it was water that brought us to Hopkinton.
Nocturne, Lake Maspinock. From the lake's edge, the stars are an imagined drizzle of light. The water, still restless, quietly licks at the night air of July. Where's the moon? Absent from my sky, perhaps it is shining in theirs, above the bonfires. Grape leaves flutter like green moths against the soft light from across the lake. So soft I cannot see the palms of my hands. I am the only one awake. The house is dense with sleep, and I soon lose its straight lines against the trees as the cricket song covers and recovers itself in the grass. I turn, and the loose strife that brushes my ankles tells me where the path is. If I close my eyes, I sway. If I open them, the dark first concentrates in furies around my face until slowly, slowly, I pick up the ladder on the float, the kayak's nose, the closed petals of the day lilies. How we grow to know each other happens in the folds of such a darkness, sometimes inflected with light. The scent of unseen flowers, water lapping against a shore, a sudden snap of branch. But like the moon and stars, I cannot see. You are there, an imagined brightness that leads towards day.
And thank you, Meg. A walking perspective from Woodville is Marjorie Tugian with her poem, The Walkers.
The Walkers. The Walkers, Woodville, Massachusetts, 1973. Three women from this quiet circle set out at dusk on summer nights to walk off extra weight. They leave husbands wandering through the half-empty houses. Children stop play to call after them. Large in the western sky, Venus shines. They walk faster, gaining the end of the street. The scent of a flowering shrub drifts from an unfamiliar yard. They pause at the lighted windows as though watching home movies. Startled by a blowing shadow, they hesitate, join arms and run, relishing their fear, and come to rest against the tilted stones in the old cemetery. They trace the epitaphs, beloved wife, still faithful husband by her side, and they laugh. They wade in the black water at the landing, recalling when they tried to walk the yellow pathway before them to the moon. The tips of weeds gleam at the surface. Above, the darkness spreads. Clouds cover all but that one planet. The road leading home is puddled with light, trees crowding either side, conversation legs. They move closer, and they walk through.
Also often seen walking in town is Denise Ann Tackey, who's with on HCAM camera right now filming the program, with her poem, Walking My Dog in Hopkinton. She will get off the camera to share with us. And the microphone's getting really excited, Denise. Now, Denise wanted to bring her dog, but we said maybe next show.
Walking My Dog in Hopkinton. I enjoy walks with my dog Kiki in and about town. While my brain's in a fog, walks slow my life down. allowing closer observation of things all around. The white picket fence at 92 Main, count on colorful annuals, expect nothing plain. Cosmos and daisies, zinnias and hollyhock, roots seek cool refuge right under the sidewalk. At 78 Main, geraniums grow tall, with purple and white alyssum throughout summer and fall. The liquor store window boxes display many hues, reds, oranges, pinks, and blues. Pick up some wine there, or some bottles of brew. Downtown can be vibrant and so much alive. Foot traffic is needed so town stores can thrive. A stop at the post office to mail a handwritten letter. Walk to town hall, a dog license I'll get her. Hopkinton Drugstore, Hop News, Swoon, and Bittersweet. Country Plus, Hop Gourmet, all line the main street. Lovely Lady Salon, Vinny's, Bill's Pizza, and Pan Thai. We stop at Sunoco for dog treats and to say hi. They know my name and my dog's name too. Come and join us for a downtown rendezvous. Stelladora de Lilies lie the old cemetery, near where the marathon does begin yearly. 130 plants to be exact. Kiki has sniffed every one, and that's a fact. We turn right to the common with its lush green grounds. Alas, no dogs allowed here, so we wave to George B. Brown. Farmers market on Sundays, and summer bands play their tunes. Jazz and some oldies during late afternoons. Colella's market is closed now. We see how things change. I draw Kiki's leash close as she starts to roam. I enjoy walks with my dog as we make our way home. Thank you.
Polly?
Yes.
Thank you, Denise. So keep your eyes open for Denise and Kiki on the sidewalks of Main Street, or skates with your skates on on some of the sidewalks too. We are very happy and surprised that Polly Brown could join us this evening, and she will share her poem Night Lights with us. I'm glad you could make it.
So I've written lots of poems about Hopkinton's trees and waters and hills and rocks. But for this anthology, I wanted to remember a wonderful neighbor. I think there may be people here. She used to work at Colella's, but there may be people who know who Audrey Claflin was. A wonderful woman. This is called Night Lights for Audrey. When we moved in, you said how good it was to see lights shining again in our small house. You weren't alone yet. Neither of you seemed old. Evening by evening, leaning on my hoe, I watched Dick, bent and lively, wielding his. Morning by morning, saw you hang your wash, a long line propped, lopsided by a pole, shifted mid-morning for the shifting wind. Hot days, late afternoons, perched side by side, you watched the traffic like a matinee, naming the whole world's business, or trying to, and probably told some knee slappers on us, your well-intentioned, wayward neighbors, who stayed awake all hours of the night, or fell asleep and left the lights to burn.
Now lamps set up on timers pretend to be you, echoing, following room to quiet room, the predictable pattern of your widowhood. By my window, I still check across the lawn, hear your wry voice as clear as if you called. Something I still need, something I still might find there.
Thank you, Polly. We asked singer-songwriter and Hopkinton resident Barbara Kessler to include the lyrics to her Hopkinton-inspired song, Little House, in our anthology, and now she is here to perform the song for you. I don't know if you prefer up here.
Thank you. It's all that yoga stress.
What a lovely evening. I'm new to Hopkinton. I've only been here 12 years. I'm a Long Island native from New York, and so I drive around Hopkinton still charmed every day. It just, this is so great. I think I imagined it when I was little, and now I live here. So this is inspired by one such drive with my daughter. It's called Little House.
Stay with me.
you for putting this together. Thank you.
Thank you, Barbara. And the lyrics are lovely as a part of the anthology. And with that, we are at the end of our program. And as I say the words anthology, if you haven't gone over and taken a look, we have a nice pile of limited edition of 300 books that we are hoping to sell by when, Cynthia?
Yes.
Any day now. And as soon as we sell them all, we will divide the proceeds and to our three charitable organizations. So the sooner the better. So please tell your friends. And if you don't get one tonight, you'd like to hear where else they'll be available. We have a guest book you could sign on your way out. And including concluding this performance segment of the event, I have insisted that Cynthia share her poem, which is in the anthology, The Sign, as I thought it's so fitting as closure to our program this evening and overall sentiment of the anthology. And we would not have a Hopkinton anthology of poetry if it wasn't for Cynthia and her idea and her great hard work moving so fast this year. Thank you so much, Cynthia.
The Sign. As a passenger of life, the changes are inevitable. Small changes, big changes. We need to be ready to reinvent ourselves and see the world with a new perspective. Be resilient and keep moving. When Hopkinton became my home, it was winter 2013. Cold weather, different culture, other language, measurements to learn. Against the winter and snowstorms, a special neighbor came to my home. Gift bag, beautiful card, delicious pumpkin bread, and a winter candle. Welcome to the neighborhood, she said. Warm hug, I smile. Special neighbors, no more boundaries. I've learned with my new beginnings. Hopkinton Running Club, where I met my best friends in the town. Tuesdays runs, brunches and laughs. Saturday runs, 5K, half marathons, marathons, relays. Teamwork, friendship. We are sharing the way. In Hopkinton Center for the Arts, my path becomes colorful landscapes, words in brushes, shades of joy. Painting is a different way of communication, of the colors that come from your heart. We are all blossoming and growing in life. In Hopkinton, the poetry flows naturally as a soft breeze. The town is very inspiring when you are ready to wake up and smell the poetry. The arts gives meaning and inspiration about life. In my early days in Hopkinton, I remember the first thing that I saw in town when I moved from Brazil. It was Christmas season, and there were two red rainbows. The sign said everything. Since the beginning, welcome to the Hopkinton. It's true, I can feel Hopkinton is a gift. We are all welcome here. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for your presence tonight. I'm almost crying.